Hey, good morning, church. Welcome to Plymouth Methodist Central Hall from church, coming to you wherever you are this morning. It's great to see you. Great to see people logging on already and lots of messages appearing in the comments.
Yeah, we're hoping you can hear us.
We've been, as normal, doing lots and lots of techie stuff. Well, Nick's been doing lots of techie stuff. I've just been standing and saying encouraging things on the sidelines. So do pop a comment in to let us know you can hear us. That'd be brilliant. Good morning to Steve and Elizabeth and Kings Nympton. Great to see you this morning.
Oh, look at all your notes.
I've got lots of notes this morning so that I make sure I say all the important things that I'm supposed to say. If you are joining us this morning, if you're scrolling through, why don't you stop and click so that the sound comes on, and pop a hello in the comments, put a like, put a comment, tell us where you're joining from this morning. We'd love to know where you are and where you're logging in from.
Penny, it is freezing. It is absolutely freezing. My hands are actually numb this morning.
It's really cold in the church. Hopefully next Sunday they'll turn the heating on. When people are allowed back in the building, which is a really exciting development. And we're looking forward to in-person church next week. It will look different. It will feel different. Gareth will say a bit more on that in the notices later on, I'm sure. I was preaching last week, wasn't I? In another church.
Yeah, we had a very bizarre weekend last week because I was at home not doing anything. And Paul was preaching in a church with
people.
Real life people.
With people?
Yeah.
It was very strange. This is really interesting that we all feel like we're going to get back to church and it'll be back to normal, but it really wasn't. But it was great to be preaching and great to be sharing with people all the same. Good morning to all those that are still logging on. Great to see you, John and Alison and Viv. Welcome to you all this morning.
Good morning, Anita.
Lovely to hear you. Thank you. That's great. How nice to be encouraged that they can hear us. Really, really super. We have got a really great morning lined up for you this morning if you're joining us.
Five cats.
Five? I wonder if we can post pictures of said cats from comments onto the screen. That'd be interesting. I think we probably need proof of five cats joining us to listen this morning.
I'm not sure what Gareth thinks about cats either, are we?
No, yes.
We know how he feels about dogs.
Very clear what he knows, thinks about dogs. Yes, look back, there's some interesting...
I think it might be similar to dogs.
Oh, okay. Animal lover. Good stuff. We've got some brilliant stuff lined up for you this morning. I'm really pleased to have Mark and Elis and Dan leading worship for us this morning.
Yeah, we've got James again, which is
and great. Gareth is in the house, as is Linda. I mean, we are properly anointed this morning. A reverend and a deacon. Get ready for some holy stuff, people. It's going to be awesome. Really, really great to have everybody here. And Nigel pressing all the right buttons on the sound to make it all come out and sound as it should, which is awesome. What else have we got going on this morning? What else is happening today? Oh, we've got an evening service tonight with communion, with the most innovative communion servers you've ever seen in the world. If anybody thought the Methodist Church weren't innovative, you come tonight and you'll find out they are. There are still a couple of spaces, I understand, but it is quite full. So why not contact the church via the Facebook Messenger or some other forms and we'll see if there's space for you. And Bible studies going on in the week as well, in person and online. Lots and lots of great content there from Daniel. Was it Daniel again this week?
Yes.
It was.
Yes. Yes.
Good. There you go. That was a really public display of me admitting I haven't yet listened to this week's Bible study.
I have. Ellis, for a few meters away.
Yay! Comments from people in the building, it's always good. They can definitely hear us. Morning to Eunice, nice to see you online this morning. And Judith, great to have you all with us this morning.
Right, we've got 4 minutes.
We've got 4 minutes. Gosh, what else have I got on the list? Oh, big, big news. Big, big congratulations to Des and Pearl Wilcox. Their Pearl wedding anniversary.
Wow.
65 years. Absolutely extraordinary.
Marriage goals.
Find the most appropriate emoji you can to put in the comments for that. Challenge on. 65 years. Absolutely extraordinary. Huge congratulations to you both. amazing, amazing celebrations.
And got a birthday
also,
as well?
I understand it's Bethan's 21st.
Oh, to be 21.
Ah, to be 21, to have the key to the door. Can you imagine how many 21-year-olds probably don't even know what the whole key to the door reference is?
I'm not sure I do.
No. Well, there you go. There. Again, old, out of touch.
Young
me.
At heart.
Young, yes. Absolutely. So huge congratulations, Bethan, one of our students. Great to celebrate with you this morning if you're here joining us online.
Oh, we're pleased the drums back as well, John.
Yeah, drums in the house this morning. Dan will be playing brilliantly this morning. Really looking forward to those. Hi to Anne and Barry. Yes, absolutely. Really looking forward to in-person next week. Morning, Mum. Nice to see you online too. And Dave and Linda in Cranley, great to have you all there joining us this morning. We were driving in this morning. I hope you've all seen various people. What's that? Not pearl, but blue sapphire.
Are we giving the wrong info?
What's pearl then? Is pearl 60? And blue sapphire 65? We will await to be corrected. Thank you for all of those comments correcting us to
what's
make sure it's
sapphire?
Right.
There what's
we go. What's blue sapphire? We'll
that's
find
all we
out.
Know, Lisa.
Yeah, we will seek clarification. Keep an eye on the comments for all the news coming. We've been watching lots of people running their own London marathons as we've been driving on this driving in this morning. Today should have been the postponed London marathon, and also would have been Plymouth Half Marathon and Plymouth 10K this weekend. Really, really, really great. To see lots of people running and still raising money for their favourite causes.
So, 65 years, blue sapphire. It's Des and Pearl, not Pearl wedding anniversary.
There you go. Wake up earlier, drink more coffee.
Pearl is 30 years, so we were well out
there. I think I'll just leave it here. I think I'm just better off that you just do the mingle. Yeah, new minglers being auditioned next week to take over.
Video gone again.
Good morning, everyone.
We're all right, aren't we?
We've got a video. Hopefully, yeah, you've still got a video. Okay. We have absolutely lit up the chat now with what should
sapphire
be.
Sapphire is 45 years, and blue sapphire is
proper wedding anniversary years. Apologies to Des and Pearl for taking the limelight away from you. We will just say congratulations on an awesome achievement. Really, really great. And hope you're celebrating somewhere wonderfully this morning.
Okay.
Hey, we're nearly at 11 o'clock. That's great. We look forward to a great service this morning. We hope and we pray that it's a great blessing to you wherever you are, and that you will really feel the presence of God with you and a sense of being able to worship and come together as one this morning.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's great to see you. And can I echo the welcome you've already had to worship from Methodist Central Hall this morning? If you are just passing by and you're not familiar with our congregation, my name's Gareth. I'm the lead minister here and be leading and speaking through our worship today. And great to be joined, as you'll see in a moment, by Mark and Elis and Dan, who are leading our musical worship, and you'll see them in just a moment, and Deacon Linda, who will be leading our prayers a little later on. So it's good to be together. There's a few people, of course, off screen that are here just helping this go ahead. So it's always very, very grateful to have them with us too. But a very, very good morning to you all. And just so that this is done properly, a huge message.
Congratulations.
Des and Pearl Wilcox, and we are grateful for all that they offer and wishing them every single blessing as they celebrate 65 years of marriage. What an achievement. There can't be many that get to that milestone. So a huge congratulations to Des and Pearl for their wonderful celebration today. It's wonderful to focus on Des and Pearl. There are a few better people to focus on, but obviously we're here to focus upon the Lord Jesus. So wherever it is that we are gathered, whether we are a few of us facilitating worship in a church building, whether we're sat at home, whether we're with others or alone, just remember that the presence of the Lord Jesus is as real with you there, whether it feels like it or not, than he would be in some kind of holy building. Jesus says that God gives us the Holy Spirit in order that we might understand that God is forever with us. So shall we worship that God who is ever present, the God that does not fail, the God that does not shake, the God who is from everlasting to everlasting. Let's worship him, give him praise and glory. Thank you, Mark.
Your kingdom first, we hunger and
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Let's pray together, shall we? Bible says that every good and perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. Father, as we approach you this morning, as the song reminded us, you are the one who is from everlasting to everlasting. You are constant, you are secure. So though regulations and epidemics and fears come and go, you remain constant. Though stresses and pressures rise one day and diminish the next, though moods come and haunt us and then as quickly as they come, they disappear into joy, you are constant. You are secure. You are the rock who does not change like shifting shadows. You are the good God who is merciful and gracious, who melts our heart with his love and covers our sin by his compassion. We worship you today, God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, God of Peter and Paul, God and Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, our Lord and God. God of the ages, we adore you and we praise you and we look only unto you. Lord, forgive us for where we have taken our gaze off you, where we've become fearful and not trusted you because of circumstances, where we've become introspective and consumed with self, where we've lacked compassion, where we've lacked zeal and desire for your work. Be merciful to us, O God. Cover us with your great grace, for we plead with confidence the life and death and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, whose blood was spilt so that we might be washed whiter than snow. We hide ourselves again under the cross of Christ, and we receive fresh mercy, fresh grace to help now, just when we need it. We receive your forgiveness, and we receive again your commission to go and live differently in the power of the Spirit. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, I understand that the feed froze a few minutes ago when we were giving our initial welcome. I won't go through it all again, but if you've joined in the last few minutes or if you missed the introductory comments, can we extend to you a very warm welcome in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to worship from Methodist Central Hall here in Plymouth. My name's Gareth. I'm the lead minister here and we'll be speaking throughout the service later on, and you would have seen, because I know the stream was back up by then, Mark and Elis and Dan, who are leading our worship this morning, and we're very grateful for their ministry. I was certainly blessed by it, and I'm sure that you were as well. We've got a couple of celebrations, and if you heard this, forgive me, but we do want to make sure it's emphasised that Des and Pearl Wilcox, stalwarts of our congregation, pillars of the church, you might say, celebrate their 65th wedding anniversary today. So we send to them our warmest congratulations and our continued prayers for the next years that are to come. And we also wish Beth Tanton, one of our students, a very happy birthday. She's 21 today. I remember what it was like to be so young. Incredible, 21 today. So we send congratulations to Beth, and we pray God's blessing upon her and the next year of her life as well. So it's great to have you with us this morning. Over the next few weeks, we're kind of just moving up a stage in our returning to church, which is very exciting. So from next Sunday, that's the 11th of October, next Sunday at 11 o'clock, we are open to a congregation to join us. We've got around about 60 to 70 spaces, depending on the different kind of bubbles and sets of people that come. And it is essential that you sign up. Children are welcome, but we're only available, we're only able to host next week children that are happy to remain in their seats or on your laps. Okay, so that's the caveat that we haven't got set up next week to do children's activities. Johnny Libby will be leading the service and speaking from the room, and then the worship will be on a screen. So we're invited to kind of join in with our bodies, and because worship is far more than the singing of voice, but that's the format. And that will be the format most likely for the next 3 or 4 weeks. We're doing this as a trial. We don't know what the next stage of restrictions will be coming from central government, and we're just trying to work with the technology that we have got. So I know other churches will be doing other things and doing things in different ways and different orders, but we can only do what we can do with the resources that we have got. It's not ideal, but we're doing the best we can. And then we're looking already at what we do at the next stage. So we're going to try this for a few weeks, and we'll see whether we can do anything different as we head through the autumn and into Christmas. So next week at 11 o'clock, you're all very welcome, but please do ask that you sign up via the church office this week. And then going back through the week, on Wednesday night we have our prayer meeting. It is on Zoom, so at 7 o'clock there's a church prayer meeting. Do join us to pray for the life of the church. We're meeting remotely, so the login will be in the midweek message, and it was in last week's midweek message. If you've not opened that, Paul Courtney, then do make sure that you get the link and join us for the church prayer meeting on Wednesday night. And then going back then to tonight's worship, we are meeting at 6:30. There are just two or three spaces left for communion tonight. It's very informal. It's not very informal. It will be fairly relaxed, but quite formal in the way we do it, in order to maintain people's safety. There's a self-contained cup and wafer in one, so nobody will be handing out elements, and you'll be stuck in your seats, so we won't be moving around or sharing the peace or anything like that, okay? So it will be fairly clinical, but there is opportunity to break bread together tonight, and we've got two or three spaces only. So if you want to come, on the off chance that you are one of those two or three that can get in, please do, but be aware that you may well be turned away if we reach our capacity, all right? I just want to be very clear about that. So Sunday night, 6:30 tonight, I'm leading the service, and we will break bread together. You would have seen a number of you on our Facebook page this week, the video about the shoebox appeal, which we often launch around this time of year. And this is a great opportunity for us to put faith into action. One of our focuses as we look to be a healthy church that transforms the world. And if you haven't seen it, there's another chance now to see it right now.
Hi, my name's Helen, and I'm responsible for the Operation Christmas Child Appeal at Plymouth Methodist Central Hall. Normally by now, lots of you will have collected boxes from me and been busy collecting items for your boxes for children around the world who would love to receive things at Christmas time. Now, obviously, this year that hasn't been possible because we haven't been in church, and with the virus and everything, we can't give out leaflets. But I wanted to let you know that you can still be involved in the appeal and really encourage you to take part. So there are two options. The first one, which is the easiest to do and the most COVID safe, is to do a shoebox online. So you visit the Samaritan's Purse Operation Christmas Child website and click on the green bar. There is a button with shoebox online. And you will be able to create your own box. You can choose the age of child you would like to buy for, and you can select the items that you would like to go into the box. So it's quite good fun. And it costs £20, and that includes the delivery of the box and everything to the country. You can also add another £5 if you would like them to have a book about Jesus. So that's a good option as well. So I'd really encourage you to take part by doing that, and we'll put the information on the Facebook page for you as well. If you would still really like to do an actual physical box, that is possible, but you will have to do it all yourself. You can download the information from the website and you can deliver the box to the Entertainer Toy Shop in Plymouth, which is in the Mall. The collection dates are between the 9th to the 16th of November this year. Really, thank you for all your support in the past, and love you to join me this year in this appeal. As it says on their website, each shoebox gift becomes a tangible expression of God's love for a child in real need. Thank you.
Thank you, Helen. I do encourage all of you to get involved with that appeal. Even in difficult times, it's important to look outside of ourselves and see what we can do to demonstrate faith in action. Delighted to welcome Deacon Linda, who's going to read our scripture for us now.
Well, firstly, it's just a great pleasure to be able to stand here and be a part of church worship here this morning. And it's lovely to be able to share with you all. So our reading this morning is from John chapter 14 and reading from verse 5. Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." Jesus answered, "Don't you know me, Philip? Even after I have been among you such a long time, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me. Or at least believe on the evidence of the words themselves. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it." Thanks be to God for his word.
Thank you. We're going to sing again together, King of Kings, Majesty.
King of Kings, Majesty, God of Heaven, living in me, gentle Savior, closest friend, strong Deliverer, beginning and end. All within falls at your throne, your majesty, I can but bow, I lay my all before you now, in royal robe, I don't deserve, I live to serve your majesty.
Father, that's our prayer, that we would be fit and ready to serve your majesty, to be ambassadors of the King and to reflect you wherever you send us. So would you pour out your spirit upon us wherever we're gathered right now, and would you pour out that same spirit upon your word, that it would be life for us, that it would instruct us, that it would shape us, and that it would form us into the people that you dream us to be. We ask this for Jesus' sake. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, friends, for leading us thus far. We greatly appreciate your ministry, so thank you very much indeed. We are concluding today our series on discipleship, what it means to be a follower of Jesus, and looking today at our final week of being a disciple, being someone that imitates Jesus. So Oscar Wilde said that imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. And of course, that's based on the idea, or on the concept, isn't it, that you see something in somebody else and you go and replicate it. You try and make it look like you try and make yourself look like them. And we see that all over society, don't we? Think about, you know, fashion icons, or these days sort of influencers on Instagram. And we see, don't we, time and time again, that people start to replicate their style, their hairstyle, things like that. You know, when I arrived at a previous church, I didn't have a beard and I had slightly longer hair than I have now. And after a while, I thought, I want to go back. This is just getting too busy, too much effort to maintain. So I'm going to go back to my previous look, which was a shaved head and a removal of all this kind of fluff around the side, just because it was, and then just let it grow wild, really, because that was the easier look. Do you know what happened in the church? Our youth worker suddenly did the same thing. His beard had started to appear. And other gentlemen within the church, in fact, one woman as well, their beards started to appear. And it felt like I was an influencer. I was setting a trend. Clearly, the folk of that particular church, a little over in Derby, saw me as such a style fashion guru that they wanted to imitate and replicate me. I've got a 10-year-old kid who plays in a football team. And when we went over the summer to go to football trials, I was struck by how much of the sort of elite level football and is replicated in the lives of these young aspirational football wannabes. Everything from the hairstyle to the boots to the celebration to the arguing with the referee. There is something about looking at people we admire and then seeking to imitate them. And so the last installment in our series on discipleship is entitled Imitating Jesus. And so discipleship, as we've learned, begins with meeting Jesus. It then is about following him, learning from him, serving him, and now it's about imitating him. In other words, trying to be like Jesus. And to a limited extent, and I must stress the limitedness of this, otherwise we'll stray into heresy by mistake. To a limited extent, God in Trinity gives us a starting point for that imitation. The concept or doctrine of the Trinity, mystical, mysterious concept that is greater than our human minds can ever comprehend, the fact that God is three and one in three, simultaneously three distinct personalities, simultaneously one unified being, and even the word being falls short of how we want to describe the mystery of God. We can never comprehend it or fully express it because it is beyond language, beyond comprehension, beyond thinking. And so Jesus, in his farewell kind of discourse, his farewell message to the disciples as recorded in John's Gospel, is trying to expand on that and trying to illuminate some of this great mystery that is the Trinity, and he's explaining it to his hearers. So when Philip says in verse 8 of the passage, "Lord, show us the Father," Jesus says to the disciples, in essence, "You have already seen the Father. Why are you bothering to ask?" "Because I," says Jesus, "am the embodiment of the Father on earth. I am the incarnate, the human version of God here on earth." And so when the disciples and when we encounter Jesus, we are also then encountering God the Father. Jesus does great works on earth. He teaches with authority and with wisdom. He works the miraculous because it is the work of the Father that is being done through him. And what's more then, Jesus, who of course is speaking about his imminent departure here, is saying to the disciples, "Look, when I'm gone, there will be another one to continue my work," which is also not just the work of Jesus, but the work of the Father. "The Holy Spirit will be given in order that my ministry, my teaching, my very essence will be maintained on earth." So, therefore, in a limited form, and I again underscore this word limited, otherwise I'll have Paul Smith and the like ringing me up and shouting heresy down the phone. There is a sense, in a limited way, a sense of replication or imitation going on here. Jesus, in his ministry, imitates the Father. He replicates, he demonstrates what God is and what God does. And the Holy Spirit does so in the same manner as well. So the Trinity sets this foundation then for some kind of imitation, and we are then sent to imitate Jesus. And we're sent to do that in two ways, and that'll be the remaining 2 points. We are sent to imitate, firstly, the character of Jesus, to show forth his life in us. So knowing that Jesus in some limited way imitates God, we are to imitate Jesus. We are to copy Jesus. We are to live out what Jesus lived out. So remember, of course, the process of discipleship is the process of becoming more like Jesus, of having our life so shaped by him that we live as Jesus would live if he were in our shoes. And if you want a handbook or a manual as to how to do that, then you look really no further than Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7. We call that often the Sermon on the Mount. And you will find a comprehensive description, an instruction, a manual, if you like, for how to live as Jesus lived. And I'm not trying to do any self-promotion here, but if you read that material and think, "Well, this is fine, but I need some further thought on it," then we have a whole series of Bible study videos that we produced this spring, from April right until July, that go through, section by section, the Sermon on the Mount. Now, I'm doing some of them, Johnny Libby does one of them, and I recommend that material to you. Not because there's great wisdom in us, really, both Johnny and I are simply replicating the wisdom of others in trying to deliver it for you, and ultimately the wisdom of Jesus. But it just gives us a comprehensive understanding of what it means to imitate Jesus in every aspect of our lives. You see, to imitate Jesus is the high calling to which we are all invited. And as I said, that is in effect the essence of discipleship, to live as Jesus lived. A few years ago, I was at a conference in Derby, led by a church organization, and I was struck as the person speaking read a verse from the Bible which I'd never noticed before. I've read the Bible cover to cover numerous times, and the one thing that I love about the Bible is that there's still stuff that you read, and you may have read it time and time again, but the Holy Spirit just illuminates a particular verse or shows you something you've not seen before. It never gets old, never gets boring, and this is a great illustration of that, because this speaker at the conference drew my attention and the attention of others to 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 1. And in the King James Version, it says this. Paul's writing, he says to the Corinthians, "Imitate me as I imitate Christ." And the speaker at this conference went on to say, could people watch your life? Could they copy you? Could they copy your attitudes and your actions? And could they then be confident, or could we then be confident, that if somebody was copying us, they would, in effect, be copying Jesus because we were so doing that? Does that make some sense? You with me? So in other words, people look at your life, and by the way you follow Jesus, and by the way you live out the values of Christ, would they be able to look at that alone and go, right, that's how to live as a follower of Jesus? You know, that brought me up short. Brought me up short. I was, you know, I thought, goodness, if people are watching me and that's the only way they might see something of Jesus, oh, I hope they look beyond. Because I was aware of my failings, aware of my bad attitudes, aware of my bitterness and ability to hold grudges and resentment, aware of my thought life that is often impure, aware of my greed and selfishness. How would you feel if somebody was taking their marker as to how to follow Jesus from the way you do it? But actually, and I'm not trying to send you down a road called, you know, called guilt here, but for a number of us watching, that actually is happening. Particularly in the last 6 months, Laura and I have just been saying to each other, we really need to watch our lives because our children are not getting the excellent content in person that they would have got from our children's work and children's groups. So actually, it always is down to us, but it just reminded us afresh that the discipleship of our children rests on us. And so are my 10 and 6 and even 2-year-old looking at me and thinking, right, that's the way to follow Jesus? And if they are, what am I showing them? What about the partner that we're married to who doesn't share our faith? What about the brother or sister that doesn't name the name of Jesus? What about the work colleague that we sit next to day in, day out? Do they look at you and think, right, that's the way to live? And we say, well, hold on a minute, Gareth, that's impossible. You're setting us a huge burden. Well, I'm afraid Jesus didn't seem to think so. If we read on in the passage, Jesus says, if you love me, you'll keep my commands, verse 15. So Jesus believes it can be done. It just can't be done on our own. And that's why Jesus promises us some help. Verse 16, I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate, what? To help you and to be with you forever. So Jesus promises the Spirit of God to each and every follower of Jesus that we might more readily imitate the character and life of Jesus. And that is key to all of this, really. To be so filled, to be so consumed, to be so continually immersed by the Spirit of the Lord, so that the life of Jesus breaks out more and more in us. The Holy Spirit's work is to produce the evidence of Jesus in us. He is, in a limited way, the imitation of God and wants to create in us an imitation of God, Father, Son, and Spirit in our lives. Gary Berger, commentator on this passage, acutely said, "The disciples' lives will be the continuation of Jesus' life in the world." So if we want other people to meet Jesus, then we need to soak ourselves, or at least put ourselves kind of under the shower of the Spirit, so to speak. If God does the pouring out, we're the ones that just kind of sticks us in the place ready to receive it. That the life of God might break out more and more in us, and with that, the character and the values of Jesus. We are to imitate Jesus' character. And then thirdly and lastly, we are to imitate Jesus' works. Verse 12, "Very truly I tell you," this is Jesus speaking, "whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father." So Jesus says we will imitate not just his character, but the things that he does as well. So let's be clear then, the things that Jesus did, healing, deliverance, all sorts of miracles, are to be continued today by you and me, the followers of Jesus. Jesus' works will be done by regular people in the power of the Holy Spirit. And so because Jesus has given us his Holy Spirit, by that same Spirit, his remarkable gifts are distributed across the whole of his people. And so then the disciples of Jesus, that's you and me, are sent to do the things that Jesus did in our everyday orbit, in our everyday life. So what I mean by that practically is that when you meet somebody who is sick, offer to pray for their healing. It may not mean that there and then in the middle of the high street you lay hands on them. Don't touch them, you're not allowed to at the minute. But you know, you stand and actually pray loudly over them. That might be the way to do it. I've got a friend of mine that does that regardless of each other's embarrassment. But it may be that you go home and pray, or pray in the car, or pray silently as you're walking down the street. But when you meet someone who is sick, offer to pray for their healing. When you meet somebody that's in need or hungry, feed them. When you meet somebody who is downcast and oppressed by darkness, speak to them words of life and hope. You see, the works of Jesus are ours to do. And that is the essence of discipleship then, becoming like Jesus in word and in deed. So as I come to a close, and I am coming to a close now, I just want to recap this journey that we've been on in the last 5 weeks or so. We've looked at meeting Jesus. All of this is irrelevant if we have not met Jesus and if we are not continuing to meet Jesus. That is the beginning of discipleship, encounter with him. Then we're called to follow. That's the first command that Jesus makes after his disciples have met him in person. Follow me. We decide to follow where he's going to take us. We decide to put ourselves in the place where we are conformed to his likeness. We follow what he does as his example. We learn from Jesus. We sit under his word. We allow it to shape our lives. We serve Jesus. Get on and get stuck in. Seeing every other person as if they were Jesus, serving them as a tribute to him. And in all of that, really, we are seeking to imitate the one who is the perfect example for us. Now, notice in all of those last 5 weeks that I've spent little time, if any, talking about the church. You see, Gary Bird says, Christians were reproducing not merely the work of Jesus, they were continuing the presence of Jesus in the world. The point he makes, and the point I'm trying to make too, is that we are sent to be disciples wherever it is that we find ourselves. That might be at work, it might be at home with family, it might be with friends, it might be in some kind of social organization. See, discipleship is not just for church, it is for every part of our lives. And as we go into the second half of this autumn, we'll be providing a number of resources as a church, both in person and online, depending on the way things drift, that can help us to be more and more Jesus-shaped disciples, that we can continue to live out his life wherever we are set, and by that be a source of transformation to others. You know, if we want to be a healthy church that transforms the world, that always begins at our door with whether we are going to be a healthy disciple that transforms the world and the part of the world where God has put us. None of it can be done apart from the Holy Spirit. He is given to be our help, Jesus says. So before we move on with the rest of our service, and Linda will lead us in some prayers for other people in a moment, let's just take a time to reflect and to seek God for ourselves. And maybe wherever you are, you know, this is an age-old practice of mine. You'll be used to it by now. I'm just to invite you, wherever you are at the moment, traveling in the car, making the roast dinner, even in the room here as a facilitator, why not just open your hands where you are? It's not a rule. Nobody's forcing you to do anything. And it's just a sign always of saying, Lord, I'm open. You know, when we kind of go to God like that, it doesn't look like we're ready to receive, does it? But equally, it's not formulaic. Lord, I'm open. And a bit like, you know, Oliver Twist, please, sir, can I have some more? We're just kind of almost with that same begging posture saying, Lord, I need more. I need more of your spirit in me if I'm going to imitate you in life, in word and in deed. So, Lord, would you give us more? Wherever your people are gathered now, would you pour out your Holy Spirit upon them? Whatever age, whatever background, would you pour out your Spirit upon us, Lord? Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, more of your power. More of your life in us. We would decrease, you would increase, and more of Jesus would be seen in who we are and in what we do. That this city and indeed the world might be transformed to the glory of your name. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful people. In Jesus' name. Amen. And if you're having anything of an encounter with the Lord, you may want to just press pause on the video and just continue to dial in to God. And you can catch up with the rest of it in a minute. Linda's going to lead us in prayers for ourselves and for others before we sing our final song.
I'm very conscious of the message that we have each heard this morning, which is a message for all of us. And I believe as we've come to God in prayer, just for that quiet moment, we continue now, still reverently coming to God as we come in our intercessory prayers. Lord, you showed yourself in Christ, our humble Saviour, that we may be one, being of the same mind as Christ our Lord. And this morning we come before you as you call us to reach out to others, those who are in need, to serve your people, to heal as you do. We read and we hear the news each day in our own country and around the world, and we offer to you the many situations this morning that need our prayers. Lord, show us how we can serve your world. Jesus, you showed yourself servant God to those in need. You fed those hungry, in body and in soul. And you taught your followers to do the same. And for us to do likewise. Lord, teach us how we can serve the needy. Jesus, you showed yourself servant God to the ill and distressed, and you gave healing and comfort, and you have given the spirit of healing love to your followers. And so for a moment, we come now to offer to you those who need our prayers this day. For those who have lost loved ones, those who are struggling, even suffering. And even for ourselves, where we too may need to receive the healing and the comfort and that wonderful spirit of healing love. Come before him now. Lord, show us how we can serve the sick and the sorrowful. Jesus, you showed yourself to be a servant of God. Help us to reach out to those that need to know you and to see you as their Lord and Saviour. And we bring before you this morning the many opportunities that we have in our church here as we engage with others through the work of the children's groups, in the process of coming back together during the coming weeks, the work of soft play, Bible study, the Discovery Cafe, worship, its leaders, its members. Jesus, you are a messenger of truth and hope, preaching to all who needed to hear good news. And by your Spirit, you founded the church that the gospel might be passed on for all time. Lord, show us how we can serve those who seek after truth and meaning. Jesus, you showed yourself a servant God, even to those who in respectable society rejected. You were a friend to tax collectors and to prostitutes. You touched and healed many, many people. And you told your followers that what they do for the least of humankind, they do for you. Lord, show us how to serve those who need to be healed, physically, mentally, spiritually, in your society, in your town, in your world. May we this day be effective witnesses to the gospel of Christ, to his way of self-giving and suffering love, to the triumph of his resurrection, and to the faith that nothing can separate us from God's love. May we, this day and the days ahead, imitate your deeds, words, and to live out to what you have called us to be, that we may lovingly serve you and others. In Christ's name, amen. And we share together, the words will be on the screen for us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Linda, for leading us so beautifully there in our prayers. We're going to sing our closing hymn, which is a beautiful prayer set to music. May the mind of Christ, my Saviour, live in me from day to day.
May the mind of Christ, my Saviour, live in me from day to day. By his love and power controlling all I do or say. May the word of God dwell richly in my heart from hour to hour, so that all may see I triumph only through his power. May the peace of God, my Father, rule my life in everything, that I may become to comfort sick and sorrowing. May the love of Jesus fill me as the waters fill the sea, him exalting, self-abasing, this is victory. May I run the race before me, strong and brave to face the foe, looking only unto Jesus as I onward go.
Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. And the blessing of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you and around you and amongst you this day and every day. Amen. Have a great week, folks.